us.
Speak for yourself.
Bless him.
I said, we're not getting any younger. We'll be the next handicap ramp. Get up there.
That's what I was just thinking. I need something over here to help me out. Was you going to say anything, or are you just going to start?
Yeah. Hey, good morning, South Jeff. Let's stand together, and let's worship our King, Jesus.
Your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. Your church, we need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. We refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captive's heart released, to hurt the sick, the poor. We pray. walking around these walls. I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise is steadfast, great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never fail me yet. I know the night won't last, your word will come to pass, my heart will see your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough, keep me within your love, my heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence, you never fail. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence, you never fail. Your promise is never fail me, yeah. I never will forget. Search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures that fade were never enough. And you came along and put me back together. It's now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. To show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me blessed. Cause the God of the mountain, the God of the valley, and there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Glory, you're the only one who cares. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who cares. You turn praise into garden. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who cares. You're the only one who cares. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
Please be seated. Nothing is better than our Lord. And we get to worship Him this morning and give Him praise for that. He's seen us through this last year. Got us through so much hard times because of His love for us. I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 10. This is Paul refers to what the Israelites went through in the desert. He said, "For I do not want you to be unaware, brothers, that our fathers were all under the cloud and all passed through the sea, and all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. And they all ate the same spiritual food, and they all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, with most of them, God was not pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now these things took place as examples for us, that we might not desire evil as they did. Do not be idolaters, as some of them were. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. But we must not indulge in sexual immorality, as some of them did. And 23,000 fell in a single day. We must not put Christ to the test, as some of them did, and were destroyed by serpents, nor grumble, as some of them did, and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now these things happened to them as an example, but they were written down for our instruction, on whom the end of the age has come. Therefore, let anyone who thinks that he stands take heed lest he fall. No temptation has undertaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond your ability, but with the temptation, He will also provide a way of escape that you may be able to endure it. Therefore, my beloved, flee from idolatry. I speak as to sensible people. Judge for yourselves what I say. The cup of blessing that we bless is not a participation in the blood of Christ, is it not? The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of one bread. And consider the people of Israel are not those who eat the sacrifices, participants in the altar. What do I imply then? That food offered to idols is anything, or that an idol is anything? No, I imply that what pagans sacrifice, they offered to demons, it was not to God. I don't want you to participate with demons. You cannot drink of the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord and the table of demons. Shall we provoke the Lord to jealousy? Are we stronger than He? And of course the answer is no, He is faithful. It just reminds us as we come to this time of communion to examine our hearts. The people of Israel had seen all that God had done, and yet many of them still had not given their hearts to Him. So this morning, as we remember the blood of Christ and the body that was broken, examine your heart. Make sure that you are His, that you've given yourself to Him. May He forgive us for where we failed Him and draw us back to Him, because He is always faithful. Let's pray. Lord, we thank You for bringing Your people through the wilderness, for making a way when there seemed to be no way. Lord, You saw them through such terrible things. Through a desert. And this last year may have seemed like a desert in many of our lives. And Lord, I pray that we would turn to the living water of Christ. Turn to You and find our fulfillment in You. You are always faithful. You were faithful to bring the Israelites through. You're faithful to bring us through. That faithfulness culminated in your Son. The love that you have for us, you poured out through letting Him die for us. Lord, fill us with your Spirit, revive in us your Word. As we remember what you did for us, thank you so much. Bless this cup. Bless this body, this bread. May it draw us back to you. We might be the people you need us to be in Valley Station, in our homes, in our workplaces. You're a great God. We love you. We look forward to seeing you soon. In Jesus' name.
Well, good morning. I'm Jeff. I've been here a few times, so you might recognize my face. I appreciate the opportunity that Brett gave me to share with you again as we start a new year, 2021. Pretty sure most, if not all of us, are ready for a new year to put the old one behind, especially after the year we've had. I understand that you all have been working through the Ten Commandments recently, and so I thought I'd just start by having you remind me of one of them that comes to mind. So just go ahead and say out loud, what's one of the commandments that comes to your mind? Not kill. I shall not kill. No gods before me, before the one true God. No idols. Okay, mom and dad, yep. And the moms and dads here want us to remember that for sure. Don't steal, don't covet, okay. And that's where we're going today. So right on cue, Brett gave me the last one. And I thought about that because I thought about how the 10th commandment, you shall not covet, thou shalt not covet, you must not covet, however you want to translate it, really is a good bridge from the first nine into not just the 10th commandment, but really life in Christ. And here's why I think that. The first four commandments really focus on God, right? Have no other gods, no idols. Even the honoring the Sabbath day for the Jews obviously was about focusing their attention on God and turning to Him. And, you know, there's one thing about Sabbath, even if we don't practice the Sabbath as the Jews did, it reminds us that we're not in charge. God is. So the first four commandments are about God. Then commandments 5 through 9 are about other people, right? Honor your parents, don't kill, don't steal, don't lie, don't commit adultery. So those are really kinds of things that happen out there that are measurable. So the commandments 5 through 9, really just even an average investigator could look at your life and determine if you broke any of 5 through 9, right? So that they could say, did you take the thing that wasn't yours or not? Pretty obvious, right? Is there a dead body or not? Pretty obvious, right? Therefore, you can say pretty clearly, did I break that commandment? But then you come to the 10th commandment, and it moves from kind of out here, out in the physical world, as it were, and it moves inside. It takes us to the inner nature of who we are. It takes us into our hearts where it says, do not covet. In fact, I want to read to you how it's described. And, you know, having gone through the commandments with Brett, I'm sure you know there are two different accounts of the commandments. One is in Exodus 20, the other is in Deuteronomy 5. Let me start with Exodus 20, verse 17. Because the beauty of this commandment, it's not as straightforward as do not kill or do not, you know, commit adultery. There's more. It gets expanded on a little bit. So here's how Exodus 20, 17 reads. Do not covet your neighbor's house. Do not covet your neighbor's wife or his male or female servant or his ox or his donkey or anything that is your neighbor's. Then this is how Deuteronomy 5, 21 reads. And listen for the slight differences. Do not covet your neighbor's wife. Do not crave after your neighbor's house, his field, or his male servant, or his female servant, his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. Now, we'll talk in a second about the differences, but the similarities are pretty clear, right? They're pretty obvious that if you're going to covet something, there has to be an other. There has to be a something, right? You can't covet nothing. There has to be someone or something that you covet. And so both commands make that clear. And there's really kind of a checklist, and it's basically pointing us to what our neighbor might possess. Now, obviously, we would expand that. Our neighbor isn't just our physical, literal neighbor. And obviously, we're probably not coveting his ox, right? Or his donkey. It's probably something else more tangible, something more high-tech than that. But really, we're coveting what he owns or what he possesses or what she has or the tools she has or the gadgets or gizmos that we wish that we have. To covet is to look at someone or something and say, I want that. And Exodus starts with our neighbor's house. Deuteronomy starts with our neighbor's wife. And that seems about right to me. As I think about where coveting starts and what it looks like. Because for some of us, the major challenge of coveting is a what. It's a what. It's something specific. Boy, if only I had that. If only that were mine, that house, that job, that bank account, that life. If that were mine, then I would be content. But for some of us, it's more of a who. Coveting starts with, if only I had that person or that kind of person in my life, then my life would be complete. Now, I don't know where coveting is most challenging to you, but I'm going to go out on a limb this morning and suggest that if you're here, or if you're watching online, if you're breathing, and I sure hope you are, if you're here or you're watching and you're breathing, then I'm gonna just go out on a limb, make a wild and crazy guess that there is some kind of difference between where your life is and where you wish it were. I'm gonna guess that applies to all of us, right? Especially after the year we've had, right? There's where our life is as we start 2021, and there's where we wish it would be. For some of us, maybe that gap's not very wide. Maybe where we are, where we'd like to be, isn't that far apart. Maybe for some of us, it's Grand Canyon-like, where we are and where we want to be. Wherever that gap is, wherever that space is, that's the place where coveting takes hold. That's the place where coveting can do its work. So for all of us, I think it's a challenge. It may start with a who, it may start with a what. But when you are faced with a place in life where you don't have all that you'd like to have, you ask, why? And how come he has it better than I do? How come she seems all put together? And how can I get that? In other words, it's the age-old challenge of contentment versus discontentment. Where contentment is being at peace, it's being at rest, it's being whole, it's being complete. Doesn't mean you have everything, but it's where you know you are at peace with who you are and who you are in Christ. Discontentment is the opposite. It's dissatisfaction. It's resentment. It's restlessness. It's unease. It's dis-ease with where you are and what you have. So that I believe the heart of coveting is not so much that we need more, but it's the belief that if we have more, we will be more. that if I could just get this or get to this place in life or get this kind of person in my life, if I could just get here, then I will finally be content. And that is the great lie that coveting builds in our hearts. You know, it strikes me that this verse, this simple verse at the tail end of the Ten Commandments, this tenth command is so vital for our time and so timely. We look back on the year that was, and I'm pretty sure nobody here would say, you know what? 2020 turned out exactly as I hoped it would. Would anybody say that? If I were standing here exactly 1 year ago today, if we were all gathered on January 3rd, 2020, would we have said, you know what? A year from now, I sure hope this year turns out like it did turn out. It was a smashing success. Probably not so much, was it? There are some of you here who obviously can say, you know, this year was hard on me financially or with your job. Either you lost your job or your job went on furlough or it just didn't play out like you expected to. So many people have been hurt by the economic realities that we're in now. But then, of course, there's realities even deeper than that, where the health of folks has been affected. I know Brian was telling me last week you all did a celebration of life, and I believe that's the pictures of the folks on the tree that you lost from your church family this year. I believe 15 folks. 15 folks who a year ago today didn't know what 2020 would hold for them. And our hearts break, your hearts and those that you loved, and we couldn't have imagined. We couldn't have imagined, whether it was COVID or something else, how it would impact our health. How about politically? Wow, did 2020 turn out like we hoped it would? I mean, I don't really care what color flag you wave, right? Or even if you just choose not a color in the whole kind of political flag waving that we do. Regardless of what you hoped 2020 would be, I'm pretty sure it didn't turn out exactly like you wanted. I don't think there's any one of us who would say, you know what? 2020 was politically the kind of year that our founding fathers envisioned when they sat down and dreamed up this country, right? This is not what they had in mind. And if all that weren't bad enough, who would have thought a year ago, 9 months ago, that one of the most important things we would have needed was toilet paper? Are you kidding me? And it's not just that we needed toilet paper. We needed toilet paper when they told us to stay home. If you're going to tell me to stay home, you better at least give me toilet paper. I don't need a lot, but I'm sure going to need some TP. Who would have thought we would have started the year coveting toilet paper? But my point, much more seriously than that, of course, is 2020 was not the year that we envisioned. In fact, it's the kind of year that makes you want to covet another year, right? Covet something different. But we're not alone in that. We are not the first, and we will not be the last people to say, you know, God, this isn't exactly what we had in mind. In fact, we see a story in the Bible. Not long after the Ten Commandments would have been given, it's a story found in Numbers 11, and it's really a story that I think explains and helps us see what this idea of coveting is about. So if you have a Bible with you, you might turn to Numbers 11, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers. Not normally known for it to be an exciting book. When you call a book Numbers, that doesn't usually get you excited. But Numbers 11 is a pretty interesting story. We're not going to read all of it, but I want us to jump into it just a little bit. Because what we see here is we see the Hebrew people wandering in the wilderness. Brian kind of led us through that a little bit during our communion time. And do you remember, this is South Jeff, so I know you remember, what is it that God sent them from heaven to eat when they were hungry? It was manna, right? It was manna. And you know, maybe you've heard this before, but manna, the word itself literally means, what is it? So God sent them, what is it, to eat? Now, I don't know about you, but when I sit down to eat, and most, hardly ever, all the stuff that my wife makes is always good, but if there's ever a time, hypothetically speaking, I were to sit down and I look at the plate in front of me and go, what is it? I'm probably not also thinking, oh, I can't wait to eat, what is it, right? If I'm asking what is it, I'm like, oh, what? I'm not sure about this. And imagine night after night, dinner after dinner after dinner, you're looking at the plate and going, what is it again? So this is the story of the Hebrew people. They're eating it. And so, of course, maybe a little bit like us, they're getting a little discontent. This is not what we had in mind. God, is there anything else up there you can send down? And so let's pick it up in Numbers chapter 11, verse 4. Numbers 11, verse 4. we read, the rabble with them, that is the rabble among the people of God, the rabble began to crave other food, and again the Israelites started wailing and said, if only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we ate in Egypt at no cost, also the cucumbers, melons, leeks, onions, and garlic. But now we have lost our appetite. We never see anything but this manna. The manna was like coriander seed and looked like resin. The people went around gathering it and then ground it in a handmill or crushed it in a mortar. They cooked it in a pot or made it into loaves, and it tasted like something made with olive oil. When the dew settled on the camp at night, the manna also came down. Moses heard the people of every family wailing at the entrance to their tents. The Lord became exceedingly angry, and Moses was troubled. It starts with this rabble. I love that word, rabble. This rabble is craving something else to eat. And you know that word craving? It's the same word used in the Deuteronomy version of this 10th commandment. Do not covet, do not crave after. And that's exactly what the rabble is doing here. They're craving after something else to eat. And they begin crying and weeping over their dinner. We don't want to have what is it again. And so they're coveting another year, another place. And did you catch? What place are they wanting to go? Where are they wanting to go to? Where they said they had all this good food to eat. Did you catch it? Egypt, right. Now, I don't know that I know a whole lot about what was going on in Egypt, but it seems like I remember that wasn't exactly a vacation, right? What was their situation in Egypt? What were they? Yeah, they were slaves. How discontent do you have to be to say, you know what, God, we'd rather go back into slavery than be here in this place where you are leading us. Man, no wonder this whole situation is a mess. I don't know if you caught the last verse, but God is angry, the people are weeping and wailing, and Moses is troubled. What a picture of what coveting leads us to, of where it takes us. In fact, if we were to read the next several verses, and if you have it open, you can look at them. Moses then basically kind of just goes to God and says, you know what? I don't know what's going on here, God. I don't know why you've placed the burden of these people on me. Basically, Moses says, I'm not their mother. I did not give birth to them, God, so I don't know why I have to carry them through the desert. In fact, God, he says in verse 15, why don't you just go ahead and kill me now? Wow. Wow. You got the people wanting to go back to Egypt. You got Moses wanting to die. No wonder God is angry. What are you people thinking? And this started over what they were having for dinner. What a train wreck. What a near total collapse because of coveting. To me, this is a picture that coveting is a virus. And if there's anything we learned in 2020, right? We learned about viruses, didn't we? You know, if there's anything else we learned what a virus can do. And so maybe, if you'll permit me, maybe what we should call this virus here is COVID-19. Maybe not. Just a thought. Yeah, it was bad, I know. But I hope you'll agree with me, it's a virus and it clearly spreads through the people, right? It is so unhealthy as it devastates them. A sickness that starts when they just look at what they have and say, God, it's not enough. In fact, basically what they're saying to God is life was better before you came along. Life in slavery, God, before you showed up was better than what we have now. Maybe that's a little bit why God was a little bit angry with them, because they were not trusting in God's provision. Isn't that what coveting does? Coveting leads us to not trust that God is faithful and that God will provide. At the end of Numbers 11, the story ends with the Israelites in the wilderness and God decides to answer their request for meat. Maybe you know this story. God sends quail kind of blown in from the sea and they're just inundated with quail. And they start eating and those who had coveted are struck with a plague while the quail is still in their mouth and coveting becomes the death of them. And at the end of Numbers 11, we're told that place of the quail and the complaining and the coveting, is given a new name. That name is Kibroth Hattaavah. Kibroth Hattaavah. And you know what that means? It means graves of craving. Graves of craving. What a fitting name for that place. And for any place where coveting and discontentment take over our lives. Because when that happens, what we crave does become our grave. When we let discontentment take over our lives, what we crave becomes our grave. It becomes the death of us. But maybe somebody would read this story and say, why does God care when people just want meat for dinner? What's the big deal? Or if we go back to the Ten Commandments themselves, maybe somebody would read that and say, if I don't kill my neighbor, if I don't lie to him, if I don't take her stuff, then what's God so worked up about? Because to be clear here, we're not just talking about noticing or appreciating something. Coveting isn't admiring your neighbor's wife. It's taking her into your bed. Now, let's be honest. Most of us wouldn't do that, and if we did, we sure wouldn't talk about it, right? But we might take our neighbor's wife into bed in our hearts. Or maybe even more likely, maybe even most dangerously, the biggest challenge is that we look at the wife under our neighbor's roof or the husband, and then we turn and we look at what we have, and it fosters discontent with our life, our family, our husband, our wife. You see, that's the destructive power of coveting. It works its way into our heart, and at its worst, it can lead us to do something that will be obvious to most people, but most of the time, what we do won't be obvious to most people, because we'll just let it fester in here, and it will change us, it will destroy us, it will mess us up inside. And where we're basically saying, God, whatever you've given me, whatever I have, it's not enough. This manna you've given me, God, is not enough. Where's the meat? And then we resent what we do have and what we don't have. And you know what? I really believe that sometimes that kind of coveting can really lead to physical consequences. I believe that there are people that have real health issues, maybe even some of you, that because of something that you're holding on to and you're keeping it inside and it is having real physical consequences in your life. But even if that's not true, underneath all of that is the inability to be at peace with what is and always looking out for what could be, what should be, what you're owed, what you deserved, what isn't fair that you don't have. You see, this, what I would call being at dis-ease, what it does is it's where we continue to ask, what if? What if? What if my job was better? What if my house or my spouse was more to my liking? What if I had what he had? What if my life was all put together like hers is? If that were the case, then I would be content. Then I would be happy. Isn't this what we see in the Garden of Eden with Eve? You remember the story, right? She and Adam are in this beautiful garden with everything they could ever want. They have like a veritable fruit fest, right? All the kinds of fruits they could want to eat of every tree. I can't only imagine what that picture would look like. Except there's one tree, right? And along slithers the serpent and says, hey, basically, did you notice that tree? Did God say you can't eat of? Well, no, we're not supposed to, Eve said. But isn't it funny, as soon as the serpent points it out, it's almost as if that's all Eve can see. And you know what? I think that's true in my life, too. I don't know about you, but it's like I'm okay with what's on my dinner plate until I see what you're eating. I'm okay with the car I'm driving until I see what you're driving. It's as if we can't take our eyes off the thing that we don't have once it's pointed out that we don't have it. And how much more real is that today in this age of social media? Even if you're not on social media, the climate that it provides, and I'm sure there's good things that social media does, I'm not trying to like speak over it completely, but one of the things that I know it's worked in my life is basically everybody is now my neighbor, right? Every neighbor, every person I know, every acquaintance, if I'm a social media friend with them, I get to see what they have that I don't, right? Because most of us, we don't put on our social media feeds the stuff that's bad, right? We don't put a picture of us puking our guts out when we're sick. We show us on the beach, right? We don't show us our empty tree or the present that was lame. We show them the really cool thing we got for Christmas, right? And so now, courtesy of social media, courtesy of Facebook and Instagram and all those other, you know, Instas and Grams, we can look at every person we have ever had any relationship with that we're quote-unquote friends with, and we can see what they have that we don't. Man, if that's not a coveting machine, I don't know what is. Again, it doesn't mean they can't be used for good, but it's something that we've got to really guard and protect ourselves in regard to. That's what we see, I think, in Genesis chapter 3, verse 6. Listen to what it describes in the garden. Genesis 3, verse 6. It says, "When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it." What a great description of how it works. We see it, and in the serpent, you know, it's our old nemesis pointing out what, hey, look what God didn't give you. Not look all the stuff that God has given you. Look at the one thing he didn't give you, and Eve can't take her eyes off of it. And now look at how good that looks. Oh my goodness, it must be good. Why is God withholding something good from me? I must have it. She takes it, she eats it, but it doesn't stop there, right? She turns and gives it to Adam. To me, that's a great picture of what coveting does. It isn't ever just about us. She immediately pulls her husband into the picture as well. So that when we see something we can't have, we often will take it, or even if we don't take it, we'll grumble in our hearts. And the one thing I believe about coveting is it's never a victimless crime. It's never just a matter of me. Even if I don't pull someone into my mess, it's going to have repercussions because the stuff in my life is going to overflow into other people. It will damage my heart, but that shrapnel will also damage others as well. Let me just give you an example of how I think coveting can overflow into other people and just mess up relationships in life. So let's say, and I'm going to just use Joseph as an example. So let's say I come in this morning and I'm singing and I'm watching Joseph and he's going through the guitar and he's singing. I'm like, man, I wish I could sing like that. I wish I could play guitar like that. You know, come to think of it, I've been here 4 or 5 times now, and not one of those 5 times has Brett asked me to sing. You know, what's up with that? And you're saying, well, that Brett, good job. Good choice on that regard. But then I'm thinking, well, you know, that's not fair. Why does he get to do it and I don't? Why does Joseph have the gifts that I don't? And then pretty soon, it's overflowing into my life and my worship. And now I'm sitting here or standing there, and I'm not worshiping. I'm thinking about what I don't have, right? Instead of opening my hands to God, I'm like saying, well, God, why aren't you giving these hands what they think they should have? And let's imagine, because I don't really know Joseph at all, hardly, but let's imagine he and I never talk about it. We never have a conversation. So he doesn't even know that I'm sitting there coveting his gifts. Even so, it overflows because I'm not worshiping like I should. And now there's a barrier. And so maybe I don't really talk to him. Maybe I kind of avoid him. Maybe I hold a personal grudge against him because he also hasn't asked me to sing either, right? And so all of that is building up, and maybe it flows out to him because I tell him, maybe it doesn't. But in either case, there's a barrier. There's a wall that's been set up between us, and he may not even know it's there. At its most sinister, coveting can just work so quietly and so, you know, kind of behind the scenes. And so it's so very fitting that the Ten Commandments end with coveting, because it's a bridge from what we do out here. Don't kill, don't steal, don't commit adultery, don't worship other gods. It takes kind of the out here world and it brings it home to say, if my heart is not right, it will eventually pour out into other people. It will poison my own heart, and that will flow into relationships. I really believe that coveting is a church killer. Because you just use the kind of humorous example of me and Joseph, and you multiply that by 5 or 10 or 20 or 50 times in this congregation, and maybe some of those coveting examples are bigger and maybe they're really small, but you imagine that over and over, how hearts are broken and distant, and words are said and then they're held onto and they're not, you know, and all of that builds up, and before you know it, you have a church where everybody is just kind of more thinking about themselves than what God is doing and what God has given us. You see, church is a place of healing. That's what God designed it to be. Think about Jesus when he came on the earth. Think about when he walked amongst. Think about the powerful healings that he did. Think about what it was like to have leprosy, for example. You know, modern day leprosy is a bacteria that then ends up, you know, it's more of a disease that can really have obviously devastating effects. But a lot of times in the Bible times, leprosy would have been a skin disease that, you know, wasn't like modern leprosy. So it wasn't necessarily devastating. It wasn't going to take your life or anything. But you remember what happened in the New Testament. You remember that when someone had leprosy, well, in the Old Testament too, but we see it with Jesus specifically, where the lepers are outside of the community, right? They have to be separated from everyone else. So that the devastation of leprosy wasn't so much the physical aspect, although that was a part of it, but even more than that, it was the relational aspect. It was the being separated from family and community. And the theologian N.T. Wright says that when Jesus came along and healed people, when he healed lepers, what he did most wasn't just restore them physically. He restored them to community. He brought them back into relationship with their family and with their town, with their synagogue, with us, with our church. Ultimately, that's what Jesus wants to do for us. His healing power sometimes may be expressed physically in our lives, and we often pray for that, as we should. But I believe his healing power is always expressed when we are brought back into relationship. And what coveting does is it separates, it severs, it breaks apart that relationship. That this church, even through a time of COVID, especially through a time of COVID, when we're physically more separated, desperately even more need the relational healing that comes when all barriers are broken down. When we simply say, you know what, I may not have what you have. I may not even be sure if I have what I need, but I'm going to trust God. And that when we come together as a church, we get to receive what he has for us. And that healing comes when we are just open to what God gives us, completely laying any coveting we have down and trusting that he will give us what we need. I think we see this in a really familiar passage in the New Testament, Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. You know these words. Ephesians 2, starting in verse 8. For it is by grace you've been saved through faith. This is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. What a great summary of the gospel. It's a reminder that in Jesus we have the gift of grace. We all need it the same. We all receive it the same. And when we receive that gift, notice what Paul says. Immediately it turns us to recognize that in the gift of grace, we then are given the ability to then bless other people and to use the gifts we've been given to do the work that he calls us to do. In other words, when we receive the grace of God, it turns us from coveting to blessing. It turns us from grabbing at what's not ours to releasing what we do have to bless others. That's how the church is a healing place. And that's how we then share healing with our community around us and with those we love and our workplaces and our neighbors and our families, is we then receive what God has given us and we then share it with others. Instead of clinging to it or grabbing at what is not ours, we take what we do have through grace and we offer it to others as a blessing. And each one of you here, I don't know what gifts you have. I, you know, just know a few of you. But I know that because God's Spirit lives in you and among you, you have a gift to share. Maybe it's musical. Maybe it's making a plate of brownies for your neighbor. That spiritual food, brownies. Maybe that's your gift. Maybe some of you, it's financially giving. Maybe it's just offering a shoulder to lean on, a COVID-appropriate shoulder to lean on, however that works, right? Maybe it's simply the joy and contentment of knowing that in this family you have found the healing and the hope and the blessing you need, and you're just going to share it with a smile, with a kind word, with whatever God brings to you. So that the opposite of what if I had this, the opposite of what if becomes what is, where we receive what is, we are grateful for what is, and then we take what is and we turn around and offer it as a gift. Doesn't mean we think everything is fine. Doesn't mean we don't speak up when something or someone is wronged. It does not mean that we accept dysfunction in church or family or community or workplace or country. It does not mean that there's some apple we can pull off a tree, like Eve sure hoped she had, that can just make everything right and give us exactly what we want or need. There is no what if will make you fully content. It has to start with what is. And it happens. It only happens when we trust that God is here. That in the midst of what is, God is. God is Emmanuel, God with us, in our messy families, in our sicknesses and our viruses, in our unemployment and sometimes our uncertain employment, in our isolation, in whatever 2020 was and whatever 2020 will be, He is, and He is here, and together we receive His grace, we receive His blessing, and we then turn and offer that blessing and healing to each other. So here's how I want to close. I've been trying this practice. I haven't done it a ton, but I definitely want to keep doing this in 2021. And I wanted to share it with you because it's so simple. You can do it anywhere at any time, and most of the time, no one's even going to know you're doing it. It's a simple practice of opening your hands. You can do this when you pray. You can do this when you're in the car driving, maybe kind of hold one hand and keep the steering wheel with the other. You can do it at work. You can do it anywhere where you need to remember that there's nothing you need to grasp a hold of or hold on. There's nothing that you need to be reaching for that you don't have, but that when you open your hands, you release whatever it is you think you want to God, even as you say, God, I will receive whatever it is you believe I should have and get. And I don't mean that in like a health and wealth way. I mean that just simply, God, I'm going to trust you with where I am, with what I have. So that if I'm struggling with somebody at work, or I'm frustrated with one of my kids, or whatever it is, just simply opening my hands, and maybe I pray when I do it, or maybe my hands opening are simply prayer to God. God, I don't know that I have what I need right now, but I'm going to trust you to provide, and I'm going to let go of what I think I have or what I saw that other person have, and I'm simply going to receive what you have for me. So we're going to close, and I'm going to invite you to just open your hands that way. Now, some of you, you may want to shoot them up in the air. That's fine. Some of you are more kind of reserved. That's okay. You might want to just do it right here. Whatever works for you, I just want to encourage you as we all bow, we close our eyes, and as we close out this service in prayer, just to open your hands, to let go of what you're clinging to, what you're grasping after, and just receive what God gives you through His grace. Let's pray. Lord, we open our hands to you, acknowledging so often these hands are reaching, they're grasping, they're wanting more. And God, right now, we just release to you those things we think we should have, the what ifs, and we trust you with what is. God, it's been a difficult year, and some folks here, I'm sure, could say some real powerful stories about how difficult it has been. And so, God, even as we open our hands to you, we pray that you would fill those hands with what we need, where it's encouragement that you would fill us, where it's strength to go another day, you would fill us, where it's the support we need or even the resources we need to make it through whatever is coming our way. God, our hands are open to you, releasing what we think we need, releasing what we're coveting or grasping after, and we are open to you, trusting you to provide exactly what we need. And then, Lord, our prayer is that we would then have the strength and the grace to then share that with others, that you would never allow us to close our hands tightly on anything, but always keep a loose grip as we receive and then be a channel to others through these hands of blessing. Lord, bless this church. Give South Jeff a year of hope and healing and encouragement of open hands as they love each other and share what you've given them with each other in this community. And we pray all this in the name of our gracious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you for being here this morning as we've started the year together. Go in peace and go with open hands.